do not believe that any of us would exchange places with any other people or any other generation. The energy, the faith, the devotion which we bring to this endeavor will light our country and all who serve it.
The 1960s were an explosive time in America, a decade that rocked the country and changed the world forever. But what triggered the eruption? The youthful rebellion, the racial conflict, the war in the streets. It was a question that haunted one of the leading reporters of his generation as he witnessed firsthand America's involvement in a fateful conflict in a far-off country called Vietnam. His name was David Halberstam.
I thought all the things that contributed to the revolution in the 60s were seeded in the 50s. A British historian named Robert Payne came and visited this country in 1949, and he wrote, "America sits bestride the world like a colossus."
Every day it's getting closer, going faster than a roller coaster.
Love, today we look back on the 50s as a time of peace and prosperity, innocence and laughter. But the decade was, in fact, full of conflict and contradiction. Beneath the surface, there lurked hidden desires, growing struggles, and brash ambitions that gave birth to many of the things, good and bad, that define the American character. This is the story of how we were shaped by a time that started when a world war ended and a terrifying Cold War began.
Going faster than a roller coaster.
Washington. The White House announces Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor.
1941, a date which will live.
We interrupt this program to bring you a special news bulletin from CBS World News. A press association has just announced that President Roosevelt is dead.
Oh, Lord, my God, when I am all wonder.
It was hard to conceive of the country without Franklin Roosevelt as president, because that voice had come in through the radio and had made us feel as though he was talking directly to us.
I see the storm.
We were out for a drive in the country when it came over the radio. And Dad had to pull off on the shoulder in order to cry. That's how we felt.
The power through the universe.
display.
Could you imagine the president dying today and blacks in the inner city crying? I don't think so. It went beyond being black or white. I think that he was daddy.
And when that news came into our office, first there was silence and then there was hysteria. We began to cry, we began to scream, because it looked as if everything that we held dear, everything that we could depend upon for safety and protection, it had suddenly been wiped out.
When he died in April 1945, Franklin Delano Roosevelt had led the country for 12 years, guiding it through the dark days of depression and war.
How great thou art! How great thou art!
With the war still raging, Americans wondered who could fill the great man's shoes.
As the nation is plunged into mourning by President Roosevelt's death, Harry S. Truman becomes president, the seventh American vice president to assume the office under...
Harry S. Truman, a former haberdasher from Kansas City, had never aspired to the presidency. Few Americans thought he was up to the job. But in 3 months, he would be forced to make a decision as bold as any Roosevelt had ever taken. The bombs that destroyed Hiroshima and Nagasaki would change the world forever. But at the time, few outside Japan could comprehend the horror of atomic warfare. Most Americans saw only the end of World War II. Time of soaring optimism. The war that had devastated Europe and Asia left the American home front unscarred. With the success of the war, everyone expected a good peace to now follow. Few could begin to imagine just how abundant or anxious their lives would become.
Well, 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 look who's here. I haven't seen you in many a year. I knew you were coming, I'd have baked a cake, baked a cake, baked a cake. If I knew you were coming, I'd have baked a cake. Hatch-a-do, hatch-a-do, hatch-a-do.
In the first year of peace, more than 2 million couples were married. By 1950, 21 million babies had been born in a seemingly endless baby boom.
Oh, I don't know where you came from, cause I don't know where you've been. But it really doesn't matter. Grab a chair and fill your platter and dig, dig, dig right in.
I came out of service out of the Navy in 46, and I wanted to go and marry the girl that was writing the three letters a week to me for 4 years. And she lived in Floral Park, had a tavern there. And I moved in with the family. There was a mother and father, her sister and brother, and myself, and a baby coming on after a year.
Despite weeks and months of house hunting, some 3 million married couples throughout the country today are still unable to establish homes of their own.
When you look at the books that you read in school, you read of people in a house. You never read of people living in an apartment, which we did, in trees. It sounds, and it's all new, you know, it was really something that you would like to have.
I guess I don't have to tell you, Mrs. Blandings, what a woman's touch could do to a place like this.
Yes, sir. A couple of coats of paint, a little pointing up here and there.
Of course, we wanted our own house, and after, what was it, 2 years? Yeah, two years in furnished rooms. And if you could see some of the dumps we lived in, it was really... Remember that attic room?
Yes.
In Jamaica? Yuck.
I've got to have a home. No one is to blame, yet everyone is to blame. There's been a lag in home construction for more than 15 years.
In 1945, Americans needed 5 million new low-cost homes, and they needed them right away.
Now there are building materials.
The elusive dream of home ownership would soon be realized by a man about to fulfill a dream of his own and invent a new phenomenon, suburbia.
Bill Levitt, as a young man working with the Seabees in World War II, has this brilliant idea, taking some of the techniques he's seeing right then and there in World War II, building airstrips, putting up housing for GIs, and bringing them back to America for ordinary people. He's sitting there at night with his pals during the Pacific in World War II and saying, you know, what do you want when you get home? Well, I want a house and a car.
Bill Levitt's special genius was figuring out how to mass produce the American dream.
We first came to see that property where they were going to build. It was potato farms, and it stretched like from here to eternity. You would see concrete foundations, nothing but concrete with the heat in. And then down the road there, we were in the midst of all the dust, was a frame job going on. And then down on the dust was where he completed was the sheathing going. And then down the road a bit, and it was like putting your clothes on, from your socks on first, you know, and then putting your underwear on and the shirt, and finally way down on the other end.
It was a finished product.
It was a finished house. And yet, you could see how it grew.
Before the war, the average contractor built 5 houses a year. In Levittown, Long Island, they built 36 houses a day, a grand total of 17,450. Designed for a family of 4, Levitt's basic Cape Cod sold for a minimum down payment at a price most people could afford.
I think there's a great ad in there. Mr. Veteran, you're a lucky guy. You know, you can buy this house with $100 down. The first day that they were going to sell them, the lines were, I mean, people started lining up 72 hours before the houses went on sale. Even Levitt was stunned.
A second Levittown in Pennsylvania was every bit as successful as the Long Island Levittown. Everyone, it seemed, wanted a Bill Levitt home.
I beg your pardon, sir. Would you mind telling me who you are and where you're from?
I'm David Poole from Atlantic City, New Jersey.
And would you tell me why you're moving here to Levittown?
Well, I'm working in this area now, and I've looked the houses over, and I think it's a fine place to raise a family, so I've decided to buy one.
Very good, sir.
My house was a little Cape Cod cottage with a trellis over the door and one window on either side. And it was 4 rooms, nice kitchen, an eat-in kitchen, decent-sized living room, 2 small bedrooms, and a bathroom, and it had doors that I could close and open and close and open with. We had always lived in furnished rooms. We had no privacy whatsoever, nothing. It was perfect for a young couple.
And we had a Bendix in the kitchen.
That's right, Bendix washing machine in the kitchen. First time I ever saw a washing machine, I think.
And we fell in love because that washing machine was underneath the stairs, you know. And before that, when we had the baby, you know, it was like 16, 17 diapers a day to wash, boil them on the stove. And needless to say, the family wanted to get rid of us, too. They didn't need a baby that was crying in that, you know, tight quarters, you know, and to have a house of your own. Man, that was the way we felt, you know.
after the Depression, all this has come on. So it was kind of a gift from heaven, you know, you found these wonderful houses to move in.
And the best thing about it, I guess, was our independence. It was the first time we were away from our parents, completely independent, and we did what we wanted when we wanted. Like any kids, they wanted to be on their own. And we were.
And we could start our family.
That's right. And the rapport between neighbors was, at first, was very good. Excellent, in fact.
Because they were all in the same boat as us. They were all first starting out, mostly young like us, and just starting with their family and their first house, too.
The new middle-class families of Levittown had one other thing in common. They were all white.
I walked up to the salesperson, and I said to him, "We're very interested in your house, and we'd like an application." And I remember what he said to me. He looked at me, he said, "It's not me, but the management has not as yet decided whether he's going to sell these houses to Negroes or not." And,
I can't believe it. You really thought you had it made. You know, everything is falling into place.
Well, I'd like you to conceive that somebody telling you that, and there's no recourse, telling you that openly and outright like that.
Bill Levitt saw himself as a home builder, not as a social engineer, and he refused to sell the blacks. There were court cases against him, and the fact is he was all too typical of what existed in real estate in America in those days, in believing that you did not have to and should not have to sell to people who were not white.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is William Levitt, who heads the largest home building firm in the world.
Bill Levitt would become one of the richest men in America by providing architectural, not racial, equality.
Unlike anything we ever encountered before.
This is one of four models which are now being built throughout Levittown. The four models vary slightly in overall design, but each has the same number of rooms, two bedrooms.
I think it was that sense that Americans really did like the comfort of having what the other guy had, but yet they could put a little fence around it and say, this is mine. And that's really a particular American genius, is to say, this is yours, this is mine, but we're still all the same.
Did you get all your trees yet? Is this the first one?
An army of Levitt imitators carried the housing revolution across the country. By 1955, three out of every four houses built were built in Levitt-style subdivisions.
I think Levittown represented to a lot of city dwellers a dream that had eluded them all through the Depression and the war, which was to have a place somewhere with a patch of green in the back where their kids were going to be able to live better than they did. And to that extent, it fulfilled that particular vision. To another whole group of us growing up in cities, Levittown was a surrender. You know, that was exactly what we didn't want to be. To us, going to Levittown would be like going to Attica.
Its critics said that Levittown was little more than a voluntary prison, a multitude of uniform houses lined up at uniform distances on uniform roads in a treeless waste. What the critics said did not matter to the homeowners of Levittown. They had built sturdy new lives in sturdy new houses and wrapped their newborn into the nest. What worried many Americans was not the conformity of their own lives, but communist Russia. In the early post-war period, the United States was confident that its nuclear monopoly would keep the growing Soviet threat in check. Then, in August 1949, the Soviets successfully tested a bomb of their own. It was called Joe 1. America was no longer the only member of the nuclear club. There were many who felt that America's new, more prosperous way of life was in deadly peril. America's scientists began to search for a new, more powerful weapon. Russian bomb ran so deep that the U.S. government exploded dozens of atomic weapons in the Nevada desert, using thousands of its own soldiers as guinea pigs.
The vacuum created by the terrific blast at 3,500 feet sucks up the sand like a cyclone and creates a veritable sandstorm that envelops GIs emerging from their foxholes. The shock waves knocked many flat. Within seconds, the familiar mushroom develops and rises to 35,000 feet with a vortex of sand rising to meet the bottom of the cone.
Mobilized to carry out the most formidable engineering job in history were thousands of the nation's industrial firms of every size and type.
Working on After World War II, nuclear weapons became the centerpiece of American defense policy. The Pentagon thought that the atomic bomb would provide a better and cheaper alternative to conventional forces.
Here it is, General Groves, plutonium.
Once the Russians had a bomb of their own, the race now began to build the ultimate weapon, the hydrogen bomb.
In fact, the president in particular had never heard of the idea of a hydrogen bomb until October 1949. There was so little military necessity for this weapon, if you will, that no one had even bothered to mention it to him. Nor had the Joint Chiefs heard of the idea. But within 5 minutes of the time President Truman heard, he asked two questions, according to Sidney Sowers, who was his head of the National Security Council. Can we do it? And Sowers said, well, Mr. President, the scientists say we can. And then the president said, well, hell, why aren't we?
Physicist Edward Teller had been asking just that question for many years. A member of the team that produced the Hiroshima bomb, he called his design for his new bomb the Super, and urged America to develop it quickly.
On the basis of present trends, we must conclude that 10 years from now, Russia will be way ahead of us. I say that this will happen, not unless we do this or that. I simply say it will happen.
If there is another world war, this civilization may go under.
Robert Oppenheimer, leader of the original atomic bomb effort, had grave doubts that any new weapon could guarantee peace.
We need, I think, to learn to understand the realities of life abroad, not so much in terms of slogans, as in terms of the lives of men. In our response to these realities, there is hope for peace.
Edward Teller had difficulty recruiting scientists to his team. Key candidates argued that development of the super wasn't necessary or moral.
In my strong opinion, the scientists have one extremely important role, and that is to make the best possible science. To find the facts, to find the possibilities, and at that point, their responsibility stops. What to do with the result is up to everybody, and through, in a democratic society, through the elected politicians, the public will has to come to the fore. I have the confidence that if we scientists find the facts, the democratic system in the end, can develop the right applications.
While Teller was willing to do what the government wanted, Oppenheimer was not. He was deeply troubled by the destruction he and his colleagues had visited upon Hiroshima and Nagasaki. He warned that escalating a nuclear arms race would threaten life on Earth. It was Teller's view that prevailed with the politicians. In 1950, when President Truman authorized the H-bomb program, resistance within the scientific community grew. For this, Teller blamed Oppenheimer.
Teller's already wary and hostile, more than he knows, I think, towards Oppenheimer. And now he believes that Oppenheimer is trying to stop his bomb. He doesn't say it was more difficult because we could never get the mathematical equation right. He blames it on Oppie for an undertow, and this is the symbolic event.
Robert Serber, the physicist who supervised the design of the Hiroshima bomb, was Oppenheimer's disciple and friend.
Oppie to turn on the charm, and so could Edward. And they both were quite vocal. Oppie was one of the few men I ever knew that spoke in English sentences. Perhaps that similarity was contributed to Teller's feeling of inferiority when Oppenheimer was so acclaimed. And Teller was ambitious.
Teller now had his own chance for scientific glory, to show that he, like Oppenheimer, could develop a superweapon. The young man who first came to the United States as a refugee from the Nazis now led the largest American scientific effort since World War II.
Was I ever afraid in connection with war? Yes. When I saw Hitler, I was afraid. When I saw the atomic bomb or the hydrogen bomb, I was not.
Why not?
Because I knew that there is always plenty of power in any stage of development to do practically unlimited damage. Knowledge is important. The only thing I am afraid of is not knowledge, is the people who use the knowledge. And there I did not have reason to be afraid in the case of the United States developing more perfect weapons.
Teller's faith in the good judgment of American democracy was matched only by his fear of the Russians. He once told a colleague that if he didn't build the super, the Russians would take over the United States and he would be their prisoner.
To imagine that he would be a prisoner of the Russians within the United States if we didn't build a hydrogen bomb tomorrow is an irrational statement. There's no question that those weren't nice people. There's no question that that was a terrible criminal regime. But there is much question that they were the real drivers of the arms race. We were the country, the United States was the country, with one notable exception, and that only briefly, that invented the new weapons that the Soviets then followed on and built themselves.
History turns its most ominous page far out in mid-Pacific, where in the enemy talk atoll, the world's most awesome weapon is readied for detonation.
It took 2 years to build Edward Teller's superbomb. At 10.4 megatons, it was 1,000 times more powerful than the Hiroshima weapon.
Well, the trouble with the super was that not only that it could be made arbitrarily large, but it couldn't be made arbitrarily small. And nobody knew exactly how small you could make it, but it was intrinsically thought to be a weapon that necessarily had to be many megatons. And there was certainly no military use for such a big bomb. And in fact, there was very little use for it at all, because the same tonnage in smaller bombs would be more destructive.
Are you satisfied from the radiological standpoint, Commander Manet?
Yes, sir. The situation is ideal since the entire fallout pattern is to the north of the inhabited islands.
Thank you, Joe.
No one, not even the scientists who had built the bomb, knew what the results of the test would be.
Niner, eight, seven, six, five, four, three, two, one,
test by 1952, who, when they saw the mic test, were frightened. It just seemed to keep coming at them as they stood on their ships watching this thing grow and grow until the mushroom cloud was 100 miles across.
With the super, America regained its nuclear preeminence. 9 months later, the Soviet Union successfully tested an H-bomb of its own. Robert Oppenheimer's opposition to the hydrogen bomb was interpreted by government officials as disloyalty to the United States. In hearings held by the Atomic Energy Commission, he was stripped of his security clearance and retired to academic life a broken man. Edward Teller was treated as an outcast by many of his colleagues for testifying against Oppenheimer, but he won the battle of the super. He would go on to advise the government on nuclear issues throughout the Cold War.
Taking to the hills, the rocky cliffs above California's Beverly Hills to visit the first atomic survival house. Only the overhead.
With the world on edge over the threat of nuclear war, Americans invented ways of coping with Armageddon.
Hal Hayes, a bachelor, spent $250,000 on this hideaway where he can sit out any atomic attack in comfort. There's champagne on tap along with a variety of stronger stimulants just in case anyone needs a bracer when the bombs are falling. And a radiation-proof curtain will keep out the uninvited gamma rays.
The weirdness of the time,
indoor swimming pool is provided.
The paranoia of the time, the atmosphere was so tense. I remember more than one time walking on the beach, facing New York, but not being able to see it, but there seemed to be a great stillness suddenly. Birds weren't flying. Something was happening. I felt immediately. Everything was just too quiet. And I looked off to the direction of the city just to see if there might be a mushroom cloud rising.
We bought a house on the Berkeley Hill with a big picture window overlooking the Golden Gate. And Emilio Segrè, Nobel Prize winner in physics, came to visit us. He said to my wife, "Charlotte, you will pay for this view with your life." He was afraid that San Francisco would be bombed, an atomic bomb. And he personally moved out of Berkeley back to Walnut Creek, about 20 miles inland over the hill.
Was a turtle by the name of Bert, and Bert the turtle was very alert when danger threatened him.
A government-sponsored campaign taught children what to do in the event of nuclear attack.
He's duck and cover, duck and cover.
He did what we all must learn to do.
You
and you
and you
and you.
Duck and cover.
I think there was probably a deliberate effort on the part of the United States government to play down the destructiveness of nuclear weapons. When children were taught that they could dive into a ditch as if this were a tornado going by, when children were taught that if they hid under their desks, covered their heads with their hands, duck and cover, that somehow that would be enough for them to survive, they were being taught at most the Hiroshima level of destructiveness.
Some of us actually refused to do it, but for some kids, this is when you found out in your peers who was the most afraid, because a lot of kids wouldn't talk about it. It was a subject that they perhaps didn't really want to participate in because it wasn't sports and it wasn't whatever. So those drills were very revealing to the rest of their classmates when we saw who was really the most afraid.
There might not be any grown-ups around when the bomb explodes. Then, you're on your own.
Very vivid nightmare of this ball of fire that was sort of out there, and I just sort of walking toward it, you know, and you know, I would see myself actually engulfed in this thing. And, you know, I remember, you know, jumping up and screaming and, you know, and, it was that, and sweating and feeling, you know, that was one of the few nightmares I still remember very dramatically to this day.
This is Times Square, New York, prior to the start of a civil defense drill highlighting Operation Alert. The drill is part of the survival phase of the fourth such test held in this country. Less than 2 minutes after the take cover signal, the streets were cleared. Times Square is deserted.
I wrote a piece for Esquire about the whole madness of the civil defense drills. And I interviewed some general who was in charge of civil defense for New York in case of an atomic attack. And he kept talking to me, you know, all this jargon. And I said, look, just tell me this. Well, what happens if an atom bomb actually hits New York? And he says, you mean ground zero? You know, I said, yeah. What if it hits Manhattan? He says, well, he says, it's goodbye, New York. So I wrote a piece called Goodbye, New York.
What would you do if you heard the air raid warning system here in Denver sound a warning that a real atomic attack was imminent?
Well, I think just what we're supposed to do, and that is to find our shelters.
I think I'd find the baby, get a chair, sit down and wait. I know nothing else to do.
You don't know where you'd wait?
Inside. I wouldn't go in the cellar. Sit in the living room.
Put your trust in what?
God. Beyond that, I have none other.
Again, the fireball. Now, for dramatic effect, we superimpose it on the skyline of New York. The heart of the metropolis would be instantaneously transformed into an inferno, while shock and heat waves devastated the rest of the city.
You really learned that there could be an absolute atomic disaster in your town. We had a nice house in Huntington Woods, Michigan, and we had a fruit cellar down there. And at my behest, and I'm not sure my wife thought I was in my right mind, but we put bunks down there, and we put sleeping bags down there, and we put extra water down there, and we put canned food down there. And I kept trying to figure out some way to reinforce the ceiling. I don't think I ever figured that out. But the theory was that when we heard the sirens go, we were all going to run down there and go in there, and we might have to stay in there for 2 weeks. So we had it stocked up to support us for 2 weeks.
A new housing development near Denver, Colorado, shows the nation's first model homes with built-in fallout shelters. The room is designed with an atomic war in mind. But behind each 8-inch thick reinforced concrete wall, it may prove to be just what the harried housewife is looking for when life with the kids gets too hectic.
You can have as much explosive force as you want in a nuclear world, but you can't necessarily win when you get that much in the world. There is a level beyond which to use the force you have at your hand destroys you as well as your enemy.
I don't want to set the world on fire. I just want to start a flame in your heart.
The United States and the Soviet Union developed the nuclear capability to wipe out one another's major cities many times over. The weapon that was designed to alleviate all fear had become the greatest fear of all.
No other will do.
The question is, was the arms race successful at the scale it extended to? Did we have to build so many? Did we have to put ourselves at such terrible risk? Did we have to nearly bankrupt ourselves? Because it wasn't only the Soviet Union. There's been one reliable estimate based on government numbers that the arms race, if you count the delivery systems as well as the bombs, cost us $4 trillion. And that was the United States' national debt in 1994.
I just want to start a flame in your heart.
Throughout the world, learn to look on the brutal face of communism. Berlin, powder keg of Europe, saw a mass demonstration of indoctrinated young Germans.
For the first time in their history, Americans faced an enemy whose ideas, they believed, were as dangerous as its military power.
Marshall Plan aid. And across the world in Japan,
communism was public enemy number one.
But far more sinister to Americans was home front communism. Union Square in New York was the backdrop for these scenes of red violence. From their ranks will come the saboteurs, spies, and subversives should World War III be forced upon America.
We know that communism is an organized threat to our way of life. But how far do you feel that we should go, we here in America, in legislating against it?
Well, I think it should be curbed somewhat. I don't know that it should be outlawed completely. I think when it becomes a threat to our democratic way of living here in the United States, that something should definitely be done about it.
Well, I think we should fight communism in every way possible. We can't force it underground, as has been said, any more than it already has.
Tales of invasion by alien creatures, a new genre of science fiction movie, played to America's anxieties about its vulnerability to attack from within.
They're like huge seed pods.
This must be the way that putty in my closet was formed.
Miles, where do they come from?
I don't know. If they are seeds or seed pods, they must grow someplace on a plant, probably.
Invasion of the Body Snatchers really struck at a way of communicating the notion that people were the same, they looked the same, but they were different. And, you know, that was a real sense. You understood, it was more about brainwashing. It was more about the notion that which was people were fed at that time, that communism was a drug that sort of took you over and that made you into something else.
Suddenly, while you're asleep, they'll absorb your minds, your memories, and you're reborn into an untroubled world.
Where everyone's the same?
Exactly.
What a world.
There'd been communist menaces, so-called Red Scares, before the war. There was one after World War I. But this time, the communist menace was supported by this huge military power, the Soviet Union. And of course, we gave the Soviets far more credit than they deserved as far as their weaponry and their reach was concerned. But it gave us a kind of a Satan figure. And people were very comfortable in the 50s. Everybody wanted to keep what he had. And the communists represented someone who wanted to take that away from you.
What happens when an aggressor seizes power in a democratic country? The Army shows you as part of Exercise Longhorn at Lampasas, Texas.
It is impossible to believe, if one looked at it seriously, that the Russians were all that big, all that powerful, that they could scare us all that much, that we had to go into this fit of paranoia. We didn't see us as the big bad wolf or the big good wolf. We saw ourselves as the little guy, although we were the biggest, roughest, toughest country in the world. And we saw ourselves as essentially defenseless.
In recognizing a communist, physical appearance counts for nothing. If he openly declares himself to be a communist, we take his word for it. If a person consistently reads and advocates...
Since most Americans had no idea what a communist was, government propaganda films provided helpful hints.
More difficult to detect are the undercover workers of communism. They can be discovered only through sharp vigilance over a long period of time.
I remember on the job, I had lots of low-level jobs in art supply houses of one kind or another over those years before I could start making a living. And I dare not bring in, of all papers, the New York Post, which was a liberal paper at the time. It was considered a communist rag by my, not just the bosses, but my fellow workers. And you'd give yourself away if you wore a Stevenson button. You couldn't do that. This is in democratic New York. Again, that showed you up as a pinko. I mean, the atmosphere was absolutely insane.
Calling the House Un-American Activities Committee to order, Chairman J. Parnell Thomas of New Jersey.
The Hollywood film industry was the first target of anti-communist crusaders.
Stripling, the next witness.
John Howard Lawson.
It's unfortunate and tragic that I have to teach this committee the basic principles of Americanism.
Are you or have you ever been a member of the Communist Party?
I believe I have the right to be confronted with any evidence which supports this question. I should like to see what you have.
Oh, well, you would.
Yes.
Under pressure, Hollywood caved in. Anyone suspected of having communist ties was blacklisted. Films dramatizing the heroic search for the enemy within hit the screen.
All right, that's swell, but I'm still a commie.
For the time being, yes. We have more surprises for the Reds, but we aren't ready to show our hand.
A wave of anti-communist paranoia swept the country in 1946 when news broke that Igor Guzenko, a cipher clerk at the Soviet embassy in Ottawa, had identified real Russian spies operating throughout North America. Arrests and deportations followed. Ethel Rosenberg, convicted of selling atomic secrets to the Soviet Union, became the first woman in U.S. peacetime history to be executed for espionage.
Yes, there was a certain amount of fear there. I never felt it. The people I lived with never felt it. Nobody where I grew up was looking over his or her shoulder to see if the Red Menace was crawling up through Ebbets Field or something. It wasn't. But there were people who felt it, and I think media particularly, it was the last days before television took over. The media in particular, the Hearst chains and a lot of the sort of right-wing conservative chains of newspapers helped feed the fear.
With the fear of communism running rampant, Americans felt they had to stay vigilant or risk losing the Cold War without a shot being fired.
Can't you see? We're after you!
The time was ripe for a demagogue, someone who would find communists wherever and whenever he chose to look for them.